now. You can find the application on kpfaapprentice.org or call us at 510-848-6767, extension 235. Step up, step out, and apply by April 11th.
This is listener-supported radio, KPFA, KPFB, Berkeley, KFCF in Fresno, and online at kpfa.org. It's time for About Health with Dr. Michael Lenore. All right, good health, and welcome to today's edition of About Health. I'm your host, Dr. Michael Lenore. Glad to be back with you today. Today starts kind of a new series for About Health. We have a new producer. We have a new technical advisor. I'm the only old thing left here right now. So we're going to be moving forward. Over the next several weeks, I'm going to bring a series of my friends who are experts in health so that you can talk to them and get some sense of what's going on out there in a variety of various disciplines. And so today we start that process. Our special guest, Dr. Ron Bailey. Dr. Bailey is the chief psychiatry at Mary Medical College. He's a well-known expert in a number of different areas, obsessive compulsive behavior, and very, very strong advocate for the expansion of mental health services in this country, overcoming the stigma of mental illness. And Dr. Bailey, I want to welcome you to our program.
Hello, Ron Bailey. I feel welcome, and thanks for having me again.
You know, this weekend, once again, we were faced with a very serious incident at Fort Hood. Here again, it's another incident. It's where, you know, someone who was not necessarily mentally unstable, but someone who had sought support for some mental challenges, took up a gun and went after a group of people, and the motive still not clear. But what I want to get from you, I think most of us and many people don't really understand the whole concept of post-traumatic stress disorder. So could you talk to us a little bit about, begin our discussion on post-traumatic stress disorder and how, why you think it's such an important diagnosis in these times and what maybe we should be considering as a nation in terms of trying to deal with it, especially in our military?
Certainly. Post-traumatic stress disorder really comes historically out of what they initially called shell shock syndrome during the Korean War 5-6 decades ago, when they began to appreciate that individuals come back from war and they would be different. They wouldn't kind of just snap right back in the normal way of thinking and functioning and behaving. Over time it grew. We coined this term post-traumatic stress after the Vietnam War in the 60s and 70s. And the idea being it happens after a trauma. The trauma can be physical. You could have a car wreck and break your leg, or it can be psychological. You can watch somebody, you know, die or be involved in an accident or what have you. And it's a stress disorder. So we consider them anxiety disorders in psychiatry, just like generalized anxiety or panic attacks or obsessive compulsive disorder or things of that nature. The key symptoms generally tend to revolve around these concerns when you are, that there's been some kind of a loss. You may have bad dreams or nightmares. One may have recollections of a prior bad event. One may have the startle response. So physiologically, you jump. You're very jumpy at the smallest sign of noise or some kind of provocation. These are all the concerns that very often occur when somebody has post-traumatic stress disorder. There's an acute type that's short-term, but many people will have what's called chronic PTSD, so it's been going on for over 6 months.
So when you have it, I mean, what are some of the more dangerous signs? I mean, you've dealt with it, I'm sure, a number of times in your experience. What are some of the keys that tell you that people are not dealing particularly well with it?
Well, a couple things. First and foremost, in psychiatry, we regularly conduct a general baseline psychiatric examination. And like in any area of medicine, we're more likely to find the more common problems, major depression, things of that nature. Now, depression disorders, which can be more common, they occur in about 5% or 1 in 20 Americans at some point in their adult life, can occur very often with another problem. So 3 out of 4 people, 70-75%, who have major depression will also have another form of a psychiatric disorder, most commonly an anxiety disorder. The most severe of those particular anxiety disorders that occur with major depression is PTSD, or post-traumatic stress disorder. As a psychiatrist, we look for the initial 5 concerns of major depression. A, we look for what we call vegetative symptoms, body changes where a person can't sleep, they don't want to eat, or they lose weight. They may have some kind of a physical, pain or discomfort. Next, they may have B, cognitive symptoms, how they think, trouble in concentration, memory, attention span, ability to complete a task. They used to in the past for them to drive someplace, and they keep forgetting directions now or how to get the job done. Third, or C, they're likely to have despair. They'll feel like life is hopeless or helpless, worthless. They may have significant guilt and be wanting to give up on everything, life or what they're doing or themselves, very low self-esteem. Fourth, or D, they can at times get to where they're psychotic, an impairment of reality, where their brain is playing tricks on them. They may, hear voices or see things or have odd, peculiar, eccentric thoughts that don't make any sense, very confused and disorganized and disoriented, very severe symptoms. And fifth, of course, would be acute violence, like being suicidal or trying to hurt themselves or others. That's kind of the 5-point process or algorithm, we call it, of a primary depressive type disorder with additional anxiety.
Well, there are a couple of other terms, and let me give out the numbers. I just kind of got involved with Dr. Bailey, and I apologize that I didn't give out the numbers to our real guests who are out there in our audience, 848-4425 and the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008 is our 800 number. We're talking to Dr. Ron Bailey. He's a psychiatrist. He certainly is very knowledgeable. We're going to talk about some terms in psychiatry. If you have a question for Dr. Bailey, if you've got something that you want to discuss, I mean, we can't do treatment over the phone, but we certainly can use your question as an opportunity for all of us to learn. So 848-4425 and the 510 area code, 1-800-958-9008. Dr. Bailey, we call this the least expensive, not the cheapest second opinion in town, and so consequently we probably have a lot of people out there who really would like to talk to you about some of the issues that they're dealing with. Let's take another couple of terms that the people throw around, we see on TV all the time. When we say someone is obsessive compulsive, what do we mean?
Obsessive compulsive disorder, or OCD, is also an anxiety disorder. They have obsessiveness, which means chronic or recurrent thoughts. They very often are intrusive or bothersome or continuously pop into the head and cause them a great deal of anxiety or stress. For example, what if I was obsessive and I regularly thought that I hadn't locked the door? Well, it's one thing to go and check the door, make sure it's locked, and go to bed at night. But what if you get up 2 and 3 and 5 or 8, 9 and 10 or 25 times a night to go and check to make sure that the door was locked? It'd be hard to get a good night's sleep. Sometimes persons may think when they're cooking a meal that they didn't go cut the stove off. So they kind of keep going back to check, those type things. Now, it's obsessive because of the thoughts they have. The compulsions are the behaviors. So the thought of not having locked the door is an obsession. The act of having to physically get out of bed and go and check which the door is locked is a compulsion. So they occur together very often and can lead to great difficulty functionally in a person's life.
Now, are there gradations of that? I mean, you hear people called obsessive compulsive who just kind of, do the same thing over and again, eat the same thing over and again. What's the differences?
I think you make a very good point. I mean, clearly, some people will end up with a variety of adverse circumstances. Obesity is a great example because they're compulsive about eating. Maybe they have an obsessive thoughts. What if I was thinking regularly that my mother died and it was my fault because I didn't move back home from a job or school or military to take care of her? Then the compulsion is the bad behavior of eating too much. The end result could be obesity.
What about bipolar? Sometimes we throw that around, and I see people use that as a final diagnosis when they either get in trouble, but I know it's certainly there are lots of people legitimate bipolar disorders. What does that mean?
Bipolar disorder is a mood disorder, or what we call affective illness in psychiatry. The most common, of course, what we call major depression. So those are products of mood or emotion or how you feel. When your listeners think of psychiatric problems in general, I tell my group that there are probably four types of clinical problems that can occur that a psychiatrist will take care of. There are these emotional problems that we just discussed. There are cognitive or thinking problems like ADHD or dyslexia or an arithmetic disorder, how they would think or do math in school. There can be a behavioral disorder. Some kids in school have trouble behaviorally. Violence and fighting and aggression is a behavioral problem. And fourth, there can be what we call psychosis, which is the most severe form of brain impairment when the brain begins to play tricks on you. And you may hear voices or hallucinate or become delusional or paranoid, all those real serious problems that unfortunately many people think happens all the time in psychiatry. That really bad stuff only really happens about 1% of the time. So within that context of a mood or emotional disorder, the two main problems you might have is if your mood is too low, major depression, with symptoms such as sadness or crying spells, low self-esteem, fatigue, lack of energy. Folks may get to where they can't sleep, insomnia. They don't want to eat any food. They lose weight. And they're often they can't function at home or at work. But the other extreme of mood is bipolar. And it means that sometimes they're down, but other times they're up. So they're on both poles or bipolar of mood. The up part we call being manic, M-A-N-I-C, or mania, and it's very scary. Sometimes persons may talk too fast or do too much. They may drive too fast and have car wrecks. They may spend too much money and go bankrupt. They may engage in too much sexual behavior or violence behavior or risk-taking behavior, you know, bungee jumping or things of that nature. And if you take too many risks, your risk of having a bad outcome greatly increased. So those are the types of patterns of behavior that can get people in trouble. And at times we will, at some point, diagnose them with a bipolar mania or bipolar disorder.
All right, 848-4425 is our number and the 510 area code. 1-800-958-9008 is our toll-free number. You don't get much time and much of an opportunity to talk kind of anonymously to a psychiatrist. So this is a good opportunity. I know the things that you're thinking, other people may also be thinking, and the answers you get may help someone else. So consider it your responsibility. If you've got a legitimate question, we'd like to talk to Dr. Ron Bailey, the chair of psychiatry at the Mary Medical College, past president of the National Medical Association, a very experienced doctor. Let's talk to Chris in Mountain Run,
Monterio.
All right. Chris, you're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Lenore. thanks so much for this show. I think a lot of times people think that PTSD is something that only happens to veterans because it's so much in the media. I actually worked in psychiatry. I was a nurse, and I was a child that was severely abused and also was raped when I was a young woman. And I had therapy and all that. I thought that was all behind me. And in my early 50s, on my job, I got into a really stressful situation with a supervisor, and I did not spot the symptoms. I was not able to be self-reflective enough to understand what was happening to me, and I went into a severe episode of depression, lost about 50 pounds in 3 months, and developed really severe PTSD symptoms, and I had no idea what was going on with me. It took a long time. A lot of different medications were tried. Most antidepressants didn't work. Finally, propranolol, it's a beta blocker, helped with the actual physical symptoms of the PTSD, and Wellbutrin helped with the depression, but it was a long haul. I lost my job and my marriage over it because nobody could figure out what the heck was going on with me, including me. So I think it's really important for people to realize that this is not something, you know, I thought with therapy that I'd had that all those things relate to rest. I did not understand that that's to come back to bite me in the behind that many years later, with having all that kind of self-reflection that I did in therapy, and really, I thought I had an understanding. I didn't understand the physiological aspect that could come back and get me again. It was shocking.
Your response from our doctor, Dr. Bailey?
Absolutely. The caller is right on all three points. First and foremost, PTSD or post-traumatic stress disorder can occur after any form or type of a stressor. It doesn't have to be that they were in the military or I saw somebody die in war, although that probably was the history of how psychiatrists began to recognize and think about this diagnosis. It can occur for a woman, as she pointed out, so unfortunately, and I'm sorry to hear that happened to you, and it does sound like you've been able to think through it and kind of work ahead and not let it continue to impair your life. So if I hear that correctly, I commend you for that, young lady. But a woman can be in a parking lot and somebody could, take advantage of physical assault her. She has no protection. And for the rest of her life, whenever she walks into a parking lot, these thoughts and these images of fear may kind of flood her system. She may think and feel that she was back in that prior event when she was being assaulted. You hear people that will yell or scream or cry out or fall to the ground as if psychologically they're back in time when that event occurred. Or it could be a man who was in a car wreck and, his leg was pinned and he was trapped, and the car was burning and about to explode, and he thought that either he or his child in the car was at risk of dying in an explosion. These events can lead to remarkably, catastrophically extreme circumstances that can affect persons going forward for the rest of their lives. The other point that she points out is that one probably does have to find ways to deal with it. You can't just ignore it or go past, because it certainly can hurt. It can impair the relationships. It can lead to lost jobs or unemployment. It can lead to a divorce, as she points out, or lost relationships or marriage. It can lead to lost health. Some people will kind of give up or quit and not continue to do the kind of things you must do to kind of move forward in life. So it can be very impairing and very chronic and doesn't just go away on its own. We think often it can require some professional attention.
All right, now, one of the things that I've always admired you for, Dr. Bailey, is your attempt to take the stigma out of mental health. I didn't always understand what the word means, but explain to us what you mean by stigma and how it impacts much of America.
Well, stigma is certainly a bad word in psychiatry because it so often adversely or negatively affects our patients and those of us who treat patients with brain-related illness. Stigma generally implies that there's fear, there's a negative consideration, there may be adversity that's unfortunate and not fairly attributed to an individual because they have a mental illness or a brain impairment as compared to a so-called physical illness like hypertension or asthma. I know Dr. Lenore's an asthma and an allergy specialist, or diabetes or cancer. Stigma is also bad because one of the things that it does is it makes people afraid to go for care even when care is there. If you'll allow me, I'll share, many of us have a story. And one of my stories is that I'm a doctor today in part because I got interested in health care when I was a young kid. My grandmother, who died at age 49 in 1969 when I was 5 years old, died of breast cancer. And over time, we found out the story that she had recognized that she had a lump in her breast years, not just months, but years before she went to tell anybody. But the stigma against having cancer or breast cancer was so overwhelming to her that she didn't go to the doctor to seek help, maybe when it still was early enough, but they could have caught it, provided a surgical treatment to get rid of it, and she could have lived the rest of her life like my other grandmother, who's 91 years old now. So clearly, lack of information or education has always been of tremendous importance in psychiatry, because if people are not informed, at times stigma will cause them not to go for care, and often that care can hurt them both in psychiatry, but also with medical illness.
All right, one of the things, let me give the numbers again, 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. Our audience is unusually quiet today, so we got plenty of open lines, and we got an hour to talk with Dr. Bailey, who's a psychiatrist, the chief of psychiatry a well-recognized international psychiatrist at Meharry Medical College. So if you want to join us, 848-4425 1-800-958-9008. You know, when we start to talk about psychiatry, you know, everybody starts to think about the terms that we've talked about just a few minutes ago, post-traumatic stress. And but there are several other issues that we've dealt with on our program through the years. Let's talk about a couple of those. First of all, one of the things that has bothered me the most about what I've seen recently is this whole issue of self-diagnosis by people of adult hyperactivity disorder. Is this a real disorder? How common is it? Are we going overboard on the diagnosis? So what do you think, Dr. Bailey?
Well, I definitely think that you're right. It should bother all of us when people are kind of self-diagnosing concerns that are serious, that are real, and that can adversely affect people's lives, that can lead to disease or morbidity, and them not functioning. Classically, ADHD can occur early in the life of a young person. It might lead to them not doing well in school or failing or having repeat grades. That can stay with you the rest of your life. That's on your resume. Or it may make you think that you're not smart, so you don't try it later on. You don't try to take more challenging classes in high school. You don't try to go to college. You don't try to pursue a really challenging and more aggressive major that may have, you know, given you a chance to go to grad school or earn a higher income. So I think that self-diagnosis is problematic. It also occurs because at times other people who you know, your neighbor or your friend, your relative or your cousin, your coworker or some classmate from many years ago, they may think that they're an expert in the area, and very often they're not. You don't see this a whole lot in, as I said, people, heart surgery or brain surgery. So rather does anybody get bad information in those areas. Unfortunately, you do see it a lot in more primary care areas where a person may think because they're common, they know somebody with the same problem, psychiatry or pediatrics or family practice, and then they can tell a friend or a colleague what to do or what not to do and often end up giving incorrect information, which can hurt that person. So I think you're right. Self-diagnosis is always risky. It puts people at a much greater likelihood of a bad outcome is to be avoided. If you have a professional problem, you should treat it medically by a professional.
But one of the things, though, that both psychiatrists and psychologists and other people interested in mental health are facing are these students going to college who say, well, look, I can't concentrate, so I need some kind of medicine to help me to concentrate. When I have seen them pretty much since they were infants, and they never displayed any inability to concentrate before. And so somehow, you know, I won't give it to them, but somehow they do manage up being able to go somewhere and get some medicine that they then immediately feel improves their concentration.
It's true. We have a five-tiered approach to a diagnosis of ADHD. It's a very common issue for discussion, so I'll share with your audience. First, in order to get a real diagnosis of ADHD, the symptoms had to begin early in life. In the old textbook, we thought before age of seven. Certainly now they begin early, for example, during their elementary years. So you're 100% right. If you're a pediatrician and you're skeptical because the person didn't have those symptoms when they were, you know, in elementary, and now they're 30, let alone 40 or 50 years of age, and they said, I have ADHD, that's not always a contraindication, but it's highly unlikely, and most of the time is not true. Next, they also have to have trouble behaviorally or perceptively in more than one area of life. If you do well in school and church on Sunday and work, but you only have trouble when you go visit your Aunt Susie, that's highly unlikely to be ADHD. So by requiring that the problem exists in more than one capacity or area of life, more than one domain, it helps in make it very clear that the problem is not person-specific, but it's a true neurobiological disorder that's based on how that person thinks and functions and how their brain works. Third, you also have to have true functional compromise, which means the person is below where they should have been. Maybe they flunked out of a grade in school. Maybe they lost a job. Maybe they lost a relationship. It's not just something that's minor or trivial or incidental in how they function in life. Fourth, there very often are issues that the person clearly has not had alcohol or drug problems. So if you see someone who only has trouble with concentration, when they are using or have been using or withdrawing from alcohol or other forms of toxic substances, be it nicotine or let alone anything illegal like marijuana, cocaine, that would not meet criteria for ADHD. And finally, it also is not likely to be a diagnosis when a person has a medical, what is a medical problem. We always rule out the medical first. So if you had asthma, for example, Dr. Lenore is an asthma specialist, and we assessed you and treated you for asthma, and your symptoms of ADHD went away, and we treated your asthma correctly, then you never had ADHD in the first place.
All right. I got a lot of questions, but so does our audience. Let's go to Chris in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Thanks, Dr. Lenore and Dr. Bailey. I just would like to ask you all to touch on, and it's interesting that you used the word stigma before. I don't even know if it's correct to use now, but, you know, in the African-American community, we steer away from, you know, this type of help. And as an African-American man, I would just like some talking points, if you would, in terms of, I work with young men, and I see what I would consider, and obviously that's incorrect, but some of, you know, the same symptoms that you refer to when you talk about post-traumatic stress disorder, and again, we're in a cycle where we see some of the effects, and we don't know, you know, you don't want to tell somebody's parent that, hey, your kid is doing this, but yet you don't want to lose the child, so I'll take my response off the air, but thank you so much for doing this critical work.
Chris, could you form that into another question, another way? Could you say,
certainly. What do we do within the community? What is the advice you give as professionals so that we can then go out into the community and try? What are talking points? How do we get our community to get behind this? Because it's obvious that we don't seek counseling the way that we should and the way that other folks do.
Yeah, I could answer that. I think that we can do three or four basic things. One, first and foremost, I think people should recognize that psychiatric healthcare problems are equivalent to all of the forms of healthcare problems. And first of all, like the norm does that by, you know, having me on the show and we having the same discussions that one would have about hypertension or diabetes or asthma. In your own home or when you go in there with your friends or if you were having a social engagement or reception and certain topics came up, people talk about their hypertension. I have high blood pressure, and I'll tell you that I take Azor for high blood pressure. People talk about their child has asthma. My baby has asthma. She sees Dr. Lenore. She's on steroids, for example, or some kind of inhaler. But some people get very squeamish and don't want to mention that their grandmother has dementia. Or that somebody's been to a mental health hospital, that's a problem when people in general see psychiatric problems different than others. That can worsen or lead to stigma. Secondly, I think what we teach our kids is paramount in this business because very often we portray this image that the psych problems don't exist in our family because our family is normal and there's nothing abnormal. The same number of psych problems exist in people's families as other types of problems, and very often they're because of what we discussed already. When they occur, people ignore them or sweep under the rug. They don't go for treatment or care. Sometimes they'll get to the doctor for the right care, and one of the runners will say, oh, no, we won't do that, or they'll never win the medication. Psychiatry is the area in medicine where persons are most likely to, when they do go to the doctor, get a diagnosis and get a prescription for treatment, never get it filled the first time. And that has to be about some fear or some secondary consideration that makes them not want to believe that they have a psych problem. They'd rather keep going forth very often with the functional problems in life, in school and at work and in relationship and in health, rather than being on a psychiatric medication every day, a pill, so to speak, even if nobody even knows about it. And the third point I mentioned is that we have to appreciate that many of the unfortunate realities of our society now, like the over-incarceration of our young men, you know, an exploding prison system, a lot of those persons have mental illness. Whether it's a small problem like depression or bipolar disorder, they got out of control and behaved impulsively and aberrantly or eccentrically, or whether it's a more severe issue, psychosis, where they're paranoid or delusional and believe thoughts are disorganized in a way that causes remarkably confusing and out-of-control behavior. And all those settings, jails and prisons are not the right place for individuals with a health care problem. We won't fix these problems with legal solutions. We need health care solutions.
All right. Thank you very much. Let's go to Larry in Berkeley. You're on About Health.
Yeah. I want to know how would be the best way to handle attacks of anxiety attacks.
We recommend, first and foremost, trying to spend a little time, whether you do it a professional or at home on your own, thinking about what are the situations or scenarios that lead to the anxiety attacks. So if I, for example, I'm a physician here in Nashville, if I only got anxiety when I was driving home on Fridays at 5 o'clock and there's a lot of traffic, I might spend time trying to avoid driving at that time on a freeway with heavy traffic. That may be the only stressor that leads me to have these full-minute periods of anxiety attacks. We call them panic attacks. If that doesn't work, that's something you can do on your own and nobody even know about it. Clearly, persons can move toward other forms of engagement, the behavioral things people can do. Some will breathe into a paper bag. And when you breathe the carbon dioxide back, it actually modifies or decreases your over-anxiety. So I have patients who have trouble driving a vehicle, and they keep a paper bag in their car. That's a very simple and free and cheap but effective strategy for some people if they have a very mild to moderate level intensity problem with these acute episodes of anxiety. It's not always about driving. It could be about taking a test. If you're a kid in school, it could be about, you know, going to a certain place or whatever, or where you're going to go, or being at home if you think that, you know, there's violence outside and it's kind of close to you. A third issue, obviously, is medication. And we've had a history of, four, five, 6 decades of many medications that lower anxiety, probably a century. Many years ago, barbiturates were popular, cyclobarbital, pentobarbital, phenobarbital, and the like. Many movie stars use those. For ages. And then probably about 40, 50 years ago in the 60s, 70s, the so-called benzodiazepines came into play. Medicines like Ativan or Valium or Klonopin, they're very popular and very commonly used in psychiatry to modify anxiety. So probably initially people kind of think up solutions to avoid the stressor. Next, maybe a behavioral modification like breathing into a paper bag that can be effective in lowering anxiety. And third, we may move toward medications.
All right, well, thank you very much for that. 848-4425 in the 510 area code. 1-800-958-9008. Let's now go talk to Denise. You're on About Health.
Hi. I have a friend who told me that when her grandmother was going through menopause, they institutionalized her because they thought she was crazy. Do you have any comments about women in menopause and that relationship to mental health?
Oh, absolutely, and I'll try to be brief, but first and foremost, I'm a psychiatrist, and I'm the first to admit we've had a long history in our world, let alone in our country, of mistreating women as it pertains to psychiatry. There's a famous name, a woman named Dorothy Dix, that 100 years ago or so got out of a mental health hospital and made it her campaign to go around the country speaking to women's groups, telling them how many states had laws that allowed a person to just put a woman in the hospital for any number of reasons, but very often it was around these issues of menopause or if there were young women, menarche, when they begin their menses, or concerns regarding their female menstrual system or cycle. And, of course, all of that was bad, and it should not have occurred, and we should be very mindful that it shouldn't occur now, but there can be some vestiges of that that still exist today. Now, what I say is that first, certainly when somebody reaches menopause, one of the physiological changes in the body is, of course, a decrease in the hormone estrogen. Estrogen is involved in a balance that very often when it gets out of balance can lead to clinical depression. So clearly there are physical changes and physiological manifestations of illness that directly occur when someone's estrogen decreases, and that regularly occurs by definition. It occurs in menopause. So it can be depressive-oriented symptoms. But what people on the outside will see is a change in thought and action and behavior. And unfortunately, in that setting, very, very unfortunate to hear that, someone took it to the extreme and hospitalized her. We think that that didn't have to happen. That person could have been treated and managed as an outpatient without having to go to the hospital successfully.
All right, thank you. 848-4425, 848-4425, 1-800-958-9008. Our guest, Dr. Ron Bailey, Chief of Psychiatry at Mary Medical College. Our topic, anything you really want to talk about in the whole area of psychiatry? You got plenty of opportunity, a few more minutes. How often do you get a shot at a psychiatrist? No, well, I shouldn't say that. How often get a chance to talk to psychiatrists? All right, let's talk to Olive. You're on About Health. Olive?
Oh, hi. I have quite a few questions. It was interesting to hear when you listed the symptoms of, like, depression and post-traumatic stress and things and anxiety disorders, because I've always considered myself as someone that doesn't have those things, but I also felt like almost all of the symptoms I had and, like, consistently in my life struggled with, like, paranoia and just anxiety from growing up in, like, an abusive household and being around a lot of different drug addicts in my life. And it was interesting. My whole life I go into, like, extreme periods of anxiety, and I tell my friends, you know, I think I have an anxiety disorder. I just want to be alone all the time. I can't handle social situations. When I ask them if I should seek medication, all the reasons that you feel this way are really valid, so you shouldn't numb those feelings with medication, et cetera. And so I was curious if you could talk about, I guess, the state of things and how it creates this, like, environment of everybody experiencing post-traumatic stress and anxiety and depression and, you know, treatment versus, like, talking about all the things that create this, like,
okay,
chronicness, I guess.
All right, well, let's get a response.
Yeah, let me just say, I think that you know, psychiatry can be tricky because we are one of the most comorbid medical illnesses. So very often when you have a psychiatric problem, a person is more likely than not to have another medical problem. Depression and hypertension, you know, bipolar disorder and asthma, ADHD and, you know, lupus, for example. Next, I'd say that many persons who have problems early on don't seek treatment early, or they can't get it, they're trying to receive it. So often when they finally do come to the attention of a professional authority, a psychiatrist, it's kind of late in the course of the illness. And any physician will tell you that it's always much more difficult to treat someone late in the course of illness than early on. So that may be an issue that comes into play. Third, you also mentioned there were some early stressors. You mentioned the term abuse or what have you. So if a person has difficulty and they don't get treated, and there's some abuse early on that compounds the problem, it really makes what could be a moderate to severe problem severe to extreme. And sometimes it can become even worse than that, become catastrophic. So my heart goes out to you because there's a lot of moving parts to the brief presentation you gave us. Let me end with a few comments. A, I think it's valuable to be in therapy, able to discuss with someone that you believe in and trust the issues that bother you and just won't go away. They're chronic, they may be old, they may be new, they may be repetitive. Some people keep picking a new bad relationship over and over and over again because there's something in the back of their thinking or their psyche that puts them at that degree of risk. Secondly, I think that it's also key to ensure that a person tries to put themselves in a situation that finds some success. Some people won't move, although they live in a stressful environment. Some won't change jobs, although they hate going every day, and it just worsens all of the burden or the albatross that's around their neck, so to speak, because they're in a dead-end job or a setting, even if it pays enough money to pay their bills, that's more harmful to them psychologically than helpful. And finally, I'd say, although some people are reluctant to take medications or things of that nature, I, as a doctor, have been very fortunate throughout a 24-year career. I've had many patients who were not able to function and had great difficulty in many areas of medicine, many areas of life, social and academic, health and financial, housing or relationship, who we finally got them on some psychiatric medication, the right medication at the right dose, and we worked to get a paradigm or model that was effective for them, and they did well and are doing beautifully today. So some people need treatment. They need psychopharmacological medical management treatment, and it can work.
All right, let's go to Abdul in Oakland. You're on About Health.
Yeah, thank you for the program. Yeah, I want to address some points that Dr. Bailey made about drugs. You know, I took care of a patient that in home care who was diagnosed as schizophrenic, and he had to he didn't want to take the drugs. You know, on a daily basis. So what the doctor would do would shoot him up every month. But it made him desire nicotine and caffeine. He would smoke all day and demand and would desire coffee all day. You had to regulate it, and it was really strong urge. And sometimes the medication might help one thing, but it hurts in another way. And one other quick question, I was wondering, on a more macro level, a community level, I don't know if you've heard of Dr. Joy DeGruy, who wrote Post-Traumatic Slave Syndrome. And I think a lot of the problems in the black community is based upon protracted experiences of slavery and the after effects of slavery. That's why so many of our young black men are in prison, and that's why our families are all disoriented. And you've got the immigrants coming in. They know that language. Like, they deal with the Mexicans and the Hispanic language. They give them English as a second language, and they give them special attention. But when we demand something for our conditions, they always want to lump it in with somebody else. I think our leaders need to concentrate and focus on the ills that affect our community in particular, and I think we need to repair that ailment that's in our community, and I think the government is responsible for it. And I think those are the demands that our community should be making at this time, our leaders, and stop going along with the okey-doke just because we got something, the homosexuals got to get it, the women got to get it. No, this is for us, African-Americans who came out of slavery, and that's why we have post-traumatic slave syndrome. Thank you.
I don't think that was a response. I think it's a good statement. Let's go to Mia in Richmond. You're on About Health.
Hi, Dr. Lenore and Dr. Bailey. Thank you for the program. Can you hear me?
We can.
Yeah.
Okay, great. I just wanted to circle back real quick to that comment about a wrong diagnosis can be dangerous and more dangerous than having gotten no diagnosis. Because in my experience, when I was a young woman, I had a lot of anxiety and depression both. And I went to a social worker whom I trusted, and I was diagnosed with ADHD, and so I'd been taking medication for almost the last 10 years, but realizing that just recently, I think that the Adderall or Ritalin I was on was actually making my anxiety symptoms worse. And so that's one comment. And then my other question is, let's say you do just want to kind of simplify your life and deal with, you know, anxiety or lessening stress. How would you do that if you are essentially broke? Like, I have 5 bills, and I can just barely make it each month, and I'm uninsured, and I live in Richmond. And I know that I could go to Lifelong Medical in Berkeley or something, but often I call them. There's no response as far as mental health.
Well, let me try a couple ideas. One, I definitely think that you're right. All medicines at varying doses don't always work for every person. So a person can get on medicine that doesn't work, or maybe they're on the right medicine but the wrong dose, maybe on the right medicine at the right dose but haven't been on it for a long enough period of time. And says out to my patients, until you've been on a medicine that is likely to work for you based on correct diagnosis and some of the genetic issues that we're aware of, and we think we have a dose that's likely to work, and you've been on it for probably, you know, 60 to 90 days. That's why I get patients telling a treatment up to 90 days, with some small changes, obviously, but they can't just take it for a few days or a few weeks and just stop. So timing issues can be both medication, but dose and time specific. Next, I also say I clearly think that one of the struggles in getting people better in any area of medicine are new stressors. So if I had I have high blood pressure. If my doctor knew my current circumstance and got me on a medicine at a certain dose, et cetera, and it was managing my blood pressure, if new stressors came into my life, what if I lost my job? Or what if my grandmother unfortunately died and went to heaven? And what if I had a bad car wreck? What if I was involved in an organization where there's a lot of turmoil and strife? Those new stressors might force my blood pressure to go up, although I previously had been on a medicine and a dose that it worked for me. So you may be undergoing some new stressors that are challenging the treatment and the dosage that you were given, and that's theoretically why it didn't really work over time. The other point is all of us change, and over time we may need more or less because of metabolism. If I can't metabolize the medicine, it builds up in my system, and I can't really excrete it or get rid of it. That change can also affect whether you do better and you function better and it works, or whether you have more side effects. By the other token, some people, as they get older, they can't maintain the treatment. They lose it a lot. It's just excreted out in their urine. So they may need a higher dose. We have some treatments in psychiatry where if you're in the hospital, you may get better, but there's no smoking policies. And then when you get out of the hospital, the same medicine, same diagnosis, same dose, you may arbitrarily smoke cigarettes, and we discourage that as well. But the smoking of cigarettes changes the metabolism, makes the medicine be excreted, or you get rid of a lot more of it faster, and then it doesn't work anymore. You need a much higher dose. So a lot of moving parts, a lot of other factors that are in play. But I'd encourage you to keep your chin up. Keep at it. The goal of life is to be functional and happy. All of our patients want the same three things that everybody else wants in life. You want a chance to, work gainfully and have a vocation, something that matters to you, whether you get paid or not. You want to have a decent place to live that's safe and you enjoy and secure and comforting to you and pleasing to you. And you want somebody to be in a relationship with, whether that is a human being, whether it's an intimate relationship, whether it's a relative or a friend. But as humans, we generally tend to enjoy that nature of engagement. Those are the three basic constructs that I want for all of my patients to be happy.
All right, thank you very much. Let's go to Cheryl and Lindsay. You're on About Health.
I have a question that I was very concerned with my sister. I think she has post-traumatic stress really bad. But unfortunately, in the year she was going through this, she lost her job of 27 years. She was seeing a doctor, had great health insurance, was seeing a psychologist. They convinced her that she had brain damage from drinking a six-pack of beer for 30 years. And I was very... He also put her on Cymbalta and Prozac together, which that I know of don't mix. And so when is it that you need to decide that your doctor and psychologist aren't enough? Maybe you should see a psychiatrist. She finally did see a neurologist that diagnosed her with grief-induced dementia. But by now, now she's lost her health insurance. And she is going to have to deal with Obamacare. And so my big question is, when should someone seek a psychiatrist instead of just relying on their private care physician?
I think those ideas are very important. Clearly, one difference between a psychiatrist who's an MD that went to medical school, they're a medical doctor, and they have a medical management-based approach, what's called a medical model or a biological approach, even though it's often to brain-related disorders, versus a person who may not have a medical model, who may be a PhD psychologist or other medical professionals who've not gone to medical school, maybe to focus on the medical orientation of the illness. The example would be if a person had clinical depression and they came to see me, as a psychiatrist, I want to make sure I get a good physical exam and a full array of baseline blood work, laboratory on them, because some medical illnesses, like anemia or like hypothyroidism, can present looking like clinical depression. So when I rule out a medical diagnosis problem that I could treat with medications, iron replacement for anemia and thyroid hormone for hypothyroidism, then I'll know that they really have a true functional-based illness. So that's one of the strategies that a psychiatrist can help with. But I think it's very clear that all of us in the mental health professions, we try to tend to work together, whether we are MD-level psychiatrists like me, or a PhD-level psychologist, or a master's-level social worker, or what's called an LPC, a licensed professional counselor or therapist. I think all of us have the ability, in different degrees and different rates, to engage in talk therapy in a way that's helpful or works for people. It's key to get into a relationship that's ongoing. That doesn't have to go on forever the rest of your life or years and years. Generally, it's, 8 sessions on average is what it takes to address the key issues of clinical depression. That can be once a week for 2 months, or some people might go, a couple times a month or once a month for, 4 to 6 months or whatever. But it gives you an idea about how much time it takes. In addition, some persons may actually need more involvement. They may have a psychologist to do the talk therapy and a psychiatrist for the medication management. We see those kind of combinations work together well also. So I'd encourage you to help your sister, stay involved, get her some care. I heard the part about the drinking the alcohol in large amounts. By definition, alcohol is a toxic substance, so it kills brain cells. It hurts making the brain work better. It's by definition what's called a depressant, a brain depressant or central nervous system depressant, so it makes you more depressed. So it's even harder to get out of depression when you're already depressed in general, and then you drink alcohol, which makes you more depressed.
All right. Thank you very much, Earlis. We're going to Mark in San Rafael. You're on About Health. We have an open line and maybe a few more minutes. So let me give you the number, 848-442-5 1-800-958-9008. Let's go to Mark.
Hello, doctor. I have anxiety, but just waiting for the call, I kind of started going into attack. Oh, it's terrible. But anyway, I had an accident in 1972, and I hit my and I fell off a bridge and hit my head, and I was unconscious for a long time. But when I came back, I had short-term memory loss, but I could do mathematical questions, and what happened was my long-term memory. I could remember back when, when I was a child, in fact, back to like 9 months, way back. So then I start scanning my thought process, and I get back to when I was a child at two, when I was going to get my shot, and how they said it was going to not hurt or anything. But after that, I got the shot, and I was jumping all over. And, it drove me crazy. It was probably the worst thing that ever happened to me. And, so anyway, I started rocking, and I rock to this day. I'm 60. But, so what it brought me up was, what I'm bringing up is, I've got like this, so, it's like autism. I know I've got it. Okay, I don't know how severe it is.
Could you frame a question for us, Mark, with a doctor?
Okay. Does the stomach, since it's a highway to the brain, would that, the things that you eat, sugar, could that, and all the chemicals that are going around now and that have been going around for years and years.
Yeah, I think I understand. Clearly, I definitely think that there's a component of what affects the brain that's influenced in large degree by what we eat or what we consume or what we drink. Many of us are trying to eat more healthy diets now. I speak to my patients regularly about fruit and vegetables, less sweets, less dessert, maybe less starches if they're more, filling. Not only might they make one meal more obese, but they also might make one more sedated and lethargic, which can have an effect on your mentation or your mentality or your psychology. I think that the sugar issue has been huge in many communities for years, and the thought or concern that children ate too much sugar and they were high energy or even at risk of some behavioral manifestations of illness, there's been a fair amount discussed about that, some pro and some con all throughout, my career. But the big issues obviously are that, A, I think we should try to eat a balanced, healthy diet. The goal isn't to be the skinniest person in the world, but to be healthy and to know what your normal body size and type and framework should consist of. Secondly, we should see our doctor regularly and get blood work and get a physical exam. Make sure that all of your regular screening tests are in order. Women get a mammogram for breast cancer. Men a PSA for prostate cancer. We all can get a colonoscopy for colon cancer, things of that nature. That's helpful for preventative medicine. And third, I think you should be actively engaged with your treatment provider in kind of planning things for the future. Somebody mentioned dementia earlier, not you, but somebody else, and it's a huge issue. We're recommending to people not just want to get to be 70 or 80, there's some thought difficulty, but earlier, in their 50s or 60s, or even earlier in some people, to work crossword puzzles or be engaged in mentally challenging activities so you stimulate your cognition and your thinking to decrease any type of brain functional decline. All issues that certainly can come in play, especially, and I'll end with this, if I heard you correctly, if you particularly had some particular stressor, physical or psychological, earlier in your life that puts you at greater risk of brain-related deficits and difficulty in functioning.
All right, thank you. Let's go to Berkeley and talk to Yolanda. You're on About Health.
Hi. I had a question. It's not really about me. It's about my husband. And a few times I've talked to him about trying to get some therapy, but he takes it as an insult. And the reason why I've asked him is because a few times he'll just be talking mostly about his two boys that him and his ex are separated, so they live with her. So when he would talk about them, he would all of a sudden just have this outburst and cry, and he couldn't stop. And so a few times I got scared, and I said, did you need me to call somebody? So it kind of scared me, but he just tried to calm himself down, which took a while. And a couple times I've asked him, you know, do you think you need to talk to somebody? I am not a qualified therapist. I mean, he could talk to me all he wants, but I wouldn't know how to help other than listen. And then he told me that he did go into depression for 1 year when his firstborn was, when he had his firstborn, and he didn't know where that came from. And so, again, I've told him, you know, can you see therapy? And he just thinks that there's nothing wrong with him, that it's fine. And I don't know how to convince him otherwise. What do I do in those kind of situations?
Yeah, that's a very good question, because so many of us are challenged ourselves or know people are challenged, and we really don't know how to describe that situation. My wife is very frank. You know, she just tells me she thinks I need help. But other than that, I mean, sometimes people are reluctant to talk to other people that have obvious mental challenges. What do you recommend for that, Dr. Bailey?
Well, I think she really presents a tricky situation, because the person very often needs to believe in or buy in to the recommendation. One of the struggles in psychiatry has often been that people don't generally feel pain when they have psychiatric problems. What drives a lot of persons to the doctor when they have other problems is that at some point it hurts, whether they broke their foot, whether they have chest pain, whether they have a odd shoulder movement because they have a rotator cuff injury. And it's the pain that drives them to the doctor more than the real problem. So it really presents quite a part of us, because often our problems do not present with pain. I've often thought it would be better if every time you had psychiatric problems like depression or bipolar disorder, ADHD, if you also had a headache. Then you go to the doctor to get the medication for the treatment, and it can be addressed. Secondly, she also commented that there may be some ongoing stressors. She mentioned it's her husband, but of course there may be some other persons involved that he's related to.
And we're running out of time, Dr. Bailey. So,
I'll simply say she clearly needs to move toward some professional referrals for him. If he won't go, I think she needs to try her level best to make that point. Maybe he'll go to his primary care doctor, if not his psychiatrist. The other consideration, though, time is short, but it really is a tough situation. I wish her well, because it can help him in the long run.
And I'm sorry for those people still on the line. We apologize, Dr. Bailey. We want to thank you for joining us on today's edition of About Health. We hope that you will consider coming back. I want to thank the people that have worked with me. I'll get all the names down next thing and give you a proper thank you. Most of all, I'd like to thank those of you who joined us and took the time. Remember, health is your biggest asset. I'm Dr. Mike Lenoir. We'll talk again next week.
To a crab feed or tri-tip dinner. It's your choice. Saturday, April 26th, to benefit the Antioch Rivertown Jamboree. This event is being held at St. George's Social Hall, East 13th Anne Marie Street in Antioch. Enjoy music, raffles, an auction, and more, including no-host drinks at 6 o'clock and dinner at 7 p.m. This is community family fun time at the hall. Once again, that's Saturday, April 26th, St. George's Social Hall, East 13th and Marie Street in Antioch, for your choice of a crab feed or tri-tip dinner. This benefits the Antioch Rivertown Jamboree. For more information, call 925-757-0972.